Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Stauffer Center for Strings in Cremona. We are just about to start a Stauffer Talk, a conversation with international artists who are members of our faculty at the Accademia Stauffer. And I'm extremely pleased tonight to welcome three exceptional guests and artists. So Julian Rachlin, Sara McElravy, and Andrea Obiso. Welcome. So this is a conversation. We take this opportunity to talk here from Sala Stradivari and the beautiful Palazzo Stauffer, which is the home of Accademia Stauffer, to talk and see about the future of music. And we do it here in this special room, along with a full room of students of our academy, young talents coming from all over the world who are studying very intensively with our great professors. So let's start from Julian and Sara. This is your first time here in Cremona, correct?
It's my first time in Cremona. Okay. I think you've been here before, yeah?
I've never played here, and I'm still not playing, but I've been here once, just visiting for one day. But in a way, it's our first real time, getting to know the city, getting to know this incredible academy.
Yeah. What does it mean for two string players to just, you know, discover the city of Cremona? What's the feeling?
It's, of course, phenomenal. I mean, it's our whole lives. Of course, we read about Cremona, we play. I mean, if we're lucky, we get to play on these incredible instruments that were made here. And for me, just to walk the streets and to see the architecture, it all somehow fits together. It's so beautiful, and there's such a we were walking last night and the stars were out. We were in the main square. There's such a warm feeling in this city. And it's really been magical to discover it.
Andrea, you're Italian, of course you're quite familiar with the city.
Yes, I have been sometimes already, I don't know, every time I discover some, you know, new boutique and some new violin maker, and this is what I think about it, the history of this city, and not only made by musicians, but whoever worked in the music market at the time, and also and the violin makers and audiences that came here, and I don't know, I'm imagining the piazza full of sellers, also, you know, and inspired other cities to do so. I think of Bologna, for example. That there were some days in the day in the year where they were selling instruments and playing music on the streets. It's just so romantic, and I don't know, makes me feel like I want to play medieval music too, you know? And not only from 300 years ago, but in general, you know, it's great. Thank you for.
You know, of course, we are working here in Cremona every day, we face this history, this heritage, now, and this legacy, and of course, also in this palace, this historical palace. We are trying to keep this heritage alive. So my question for you is how we can actually project this heritage and this tradition of classical music, of violin making, into the future.
I think that you are doing it. You are setting an example, and every important institution, it's an obligation to create structures and formats so that classical music will survive another 100, 200, 300, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 years. It's our obligation. Every single student here, every single person working at the academy, also all the people, there are so many people involved in this project, I'm sure, although, as you told me, you are working with a very small team and you have achieved an incredible result, also with this villa, spending years to create it into the also technological space, not just historically to rebuild this from a ruin and to create one of the most stunning academies for the young generation and also for us. Well, I speak for myself, who is not so young anymore. At least as a violinist, I'm not young anymore. As a conductor, I'm fairly young. But to have the possibility for all of us to come to a city of such history, but not just, be amazed with the history, but to be amazed with the presence, with what you are creating for everybody, for the most talented musicians. And I think this is, in a way, of course, the Stauffer Academy goes back into the 70s, as I learned, yeah. But this is, in some way, a new beginning. Okay. And we are very honored. I think all of us can speak for all of the faculty members and also for the students. We are extremely honored and full of joy and of gratitude that you are giving us this possibility to move forward.
I think it's also, for me, especially poignant and I guess I could say hopeful that you reopened the center when you did, during the last year. With everything the whole world has been through, we've all been through, but I think I can say especially the classical music world, to see organizations like this that are still creating, still believing, still dreaming, still finding the greatest young talent. This has been so inspiring the last few days, knowing what's coming, who the young people are. I mean, this is really very special. And I think more organizations need to see this and believe it and create.
Yeah, and exactly. I think the same. I completely agree. And I'm so honored to be amongst these stars of the music, and for me it's one of the first times, really, and I'm so grateful to have and to learn from my colleagues, and I'm looking forward to the next days, and also this exchange generationally, as we were talking socially, is fundamental, because it starts from this and then it goes to other subjects, and it goes to governments. And this is a strong message, and I hope that, as Julian was saying before, that other institutions in the world will follow this, and also for their historical part, for their specific unique part, and also for what could connect us, and or them to us, and for us to get connected. So, I'm honored, yeah.
We are honored to have you all here, yeah. Also our students, and it's about really joining forces together. We feel a responsibility with our foundation, of course, to play our part, but then in the end of the day, it's really about us, the community. We are not here just, to celebrate the greatness of this palace or the greatness of the past. We are here to understand together how we can make an impact today. And hopefully tomorrow for the future of music. And this is something that we need to do together. We as a foundation, you as artists, you as the future of music, we need to share a vision, but we need also to build a vision together. Mm-hmm. And this goes to talking about education. You are extremely active artists, very busy with your career, but you are also very committed and passionate teachers. So. Let's start from Andrea. Andrea, you're super young, but you are already in the position to share your experience and also to share your vision about music. So what does it mean to you to have this interaction with the students?
Oh, yeah. I think in a moment, in this present moment, where there could be some, of course, the period that we had, it slowed down everything, but the interactions and the connection are slowed down, everybody just get distanced. And then for me, I want the opposite of that, and I have the urgency, I feel this urgency. And I feel that in the last 50 years, 40 years, there was somehow a consume of what was already the great 20th century. But now I think this propulsion, there is this engine that is, I feel it, it's starting, and it's not only in me, and the curiosity and to learn and to really try to and to make this exchange, like still keeping learning because you have this urgency, but at the same time, and know your colleagues and students, and then also learning from them more, as we would think, because as I'm 27, and I play in an orchestra 50% of my time in Santa Cecilia, and then part of my commitment as I got for the third time graduated was exactly this. I said, I feel so alone now that I know all these things, and the solitude cannot be just that, you know. If not, I would feel really Leopardi, and then if Leopardi had a telephone, I don't know what he would do. But he was a real genius. But I'm saying, at the same time, this balance in offering to the audiences that don't have to be forgotten at all, and to learn from the next generations of audiences and musicians that will come to listen to our own concerts, and then colleagues, and one day the teachers that will come to their concert. This is exactly the future I imagine, and I want to be. I try my best to be part of it. Yeah.
I really appreciate being in this environment that's celebrating learning, and I feel it's learning on so many different levels. You're bringing in specialists. Hill was here, Hill and Sons, just doing presentations, talking about sound. You have phenomenal composers, instrumentalists, and also within the student body, the wonderful artists you invite. It's, I think, really great that you have the string quartets, you have the solo, and for me, this is very important, that we're all not just focusing in one area, but that we're open to all the different facets of the classical music world and what we can learn from each area. I originally came from the string quartet world. That's where my teaching started in the US. And then now in Europe, I do more teaching, actually doing solo with viola and violinists. But I must say that the mixture of, for me, these three different things, it brings so much more depth and has taught me so much. Getting to sit and analyze a string quartet, and then the next hour getting to hear a wonderful duo or a beautiful Schumann. So, I mean, this is, it's been really great to experience music in this way. And it also helps me, I think we can all agree, we were just speaking about this morning, but when you're teaching, you're really analyzing yourself. And what are the decisions I make? And the why do I do this? Why? How am I doing this? How do I explain this? And again, maybe it comes back to this idea of communicating and finding more ways as we go into the 21st century and as we have to combat these difficulties, is how do we communicate with each other?
Julian, in this regard, is different today to become an artist? I mean, the process is different from what, for instance, you went through when you were a student?
I don't think so. I think that I was also very, very lucky to be, able to play to some of my heroes, to take lessons, to visit master classes, to sometimes just as listening, sometimes participating, and to meet some of your idols is something unbelievable. I mean, sometimes you are very disappointed, and sometimes not. But it forms you. And I mean, what means teaching? I mean, what is the whole point of being a teacher? The whole point is to help somebody who is curious, to help them make their own choices and make their own mistakes. So help them like when you have a child and you help the child to become herself or himself a complete human being. And, you know, one day the child starts to walk, and then, you know, after 14, 15 years, they don't want to have anything to do with you, and they want to do to have their own life, and they should. And this is the same for the students. We are here to give, of course, some of our ideas, to give everything what we have, first of all, learned mm-hmm. from our wonderful teachers, but then also what we have processed. And for me personally, the responsibility lies much more with the students than with the teachers. For us, it's much easier. We give you what we know, what we think is right, and of course we're trying to give everything what we have. But that's it. We have what we have. But you have the much bigger responsibility to extract the information, whatever information you think is good for you, from all the things you hear. And then this is not enough just to take information and try to copy it or to do whatever we say. The responsibility of the student or the talent is, what do I as a student do with the information to make it mine? And through that information I will have, hopefully, my own ideas, and over the years create my own personality and identity. Yeah. And I think this is the most rewarding feeling for a teacher, when he sees the student not being and not playing like a student, but becoming her and his own individual.
And I guess the goal could be, each generation, hopefully we have much better teachers as time goes, you know? It should be that way.
Right. Yeah,
the absolutely. Next generation should be much better than us, and then the next, you know?
Yes. Julian, you just mentioned talent now, and I see, well, also staying close to the students, always this extremely hard work in finding a balance between talent, discipline, creativity. You know, you want to express yourself in a freely way, you know, with a freedom, but at the same time you have to control everything if you want to, you know, become a top professional player. So how you guys find your personal balance between managing your talent, express yourself extremely openly, you know, but then still continue to be very disciplined with your work?
Yes. That's the first thing I thought when I was little, like, I need discipline now. Because I thought I didn't lie to myself. I acknowledged, and it was good that I acknowledged that, and many people should acknowledge, maybe more, that they have talent. So, as Julian was saying, to take that responsibility, because sometimes this process is missing, that they don't see talent, maybe because their parents don't listen to them enough, or maybe the teacher don't listen to them enough, or the society don't listen to them enough. And so, and I find that I needed this discipline, and I was so lucky at the time to meet Boris Belkin, who just saw this crazy little Paganino. And I said, okay, we'll do Do Re Mi Fa Sol now, and we'll do, you know, little, you know, exercise. And it started from the voice. Our voice as a string player is this. And, well, I don't want to maybe now get to the technical part, but as your question goes, then, yes, how to balance these two things? Well, when we perform, then it needs to be whatever we reached that balance in that day. Is never gonna. It's always as we were saying. It's a process, but definitely we don't have to think that also without as much talent we cannot reach either a certain level. Maybe we need this also. We need also Sundays at grandma's home with guitars, and I'm saying this honestly because my grandma used to play mandolino and guitar and was not a professional musician. So also at the bottom of it, we need this scale that nobody have to feel, I feel I'm less talented or more. Well, everybody looks at them and think about their life and their own But also, I think I would like to imagine restaurants with more good instrumentalists that play, and that they have that is also, and they enjoy that, and also in the Sunday lasagna, and then after lasagna and amaro, you take the instruments and with your cows and but weren't you a lawyer? Yes, I take the guitar and you start singing. This is what's missing in this period of time, where I find that we are trying not to be isolated anymore,
I think too, as we mature as artists, for me to be a full musician, it takes a number of things. I think focusing too much on talent, I know our culture loves this, like, so talented, prodigy. We always say talent is actually 2%, 98% is the work. And I think everyone in this room, of course, you can be extremely talented, but there has to be a balance of the work and also learning to enjoy life, finding the beauty and to manage the stress. I think talent is can be a complicated.
Paolo, you're asking very philosophical questions here. I mean, you know, when you cook, it's also kind of 95% of the time you're just cutting. You're chopping and chopping and chopping, no? It's the most boring thing, yeah? But it has something like a meditation, yeah? That we love to cook with Sarah. We spent hours in the kitchen chopping and preparing, and only after like 4 or 5 hours the magic starts, you know? Then when everything is kind of chopped and prepared and pre-prepared, and only then starts the interesting part, you know, where you start to combine the spices and the tastes you know, you follow the recipe or you don't follow the recipe or you leave the recipe. It's also in the music like this. We have, you know, we have to do exactly the same. 95%, it's so boring in a way, because we have to brush our teeth and, you know, shower but I mean, musically speaking, we have to do our homework, and our homework is very, very dry. Most of the time, because if we don't do this homework, then it's putting perfume, you know, without showering for 3 weeks, you know? I mean, I could even say something more extreme, but we are here on a live stream, so I will try to be as elegant as possible, but it's really in every profession, not just in music. I think, you know, in what you are doing also. It takes an incredible amount of boring work and I don't want to do it, it's not very interesting, but I know why I am doing it, because there will come the day where all of this work, where we realize why we're doing this. And this is the moment when we go on stage. This is when we realize, when our questions are answered, because this feeling nobody can share with us, except of the people that know what it is, how it feels to be connected to a genius like Schubert on an incredible stage, and to have the audience listening, appreciating, and to be on stage with other great musicians. This is our religion, in a way. And this is the moment when it is very clear why we do what we do, and why we chose to do this, why we dedicate most of our day and our life to our passion. And there is nothing more beautiful, but there is also nothing more, you know, dry. But without this dryness and without this discipline that you mentioned, there is absolutely no point in even saying this is talent. Talent is absolutely nothing. It's only the dot on the eye. It's what comes last and what will make the difference.
In the end,
this makes the difference. This makes the public say, I don't know what happened, but something happened today. And I'm...
It's the je ne sais quoi. Yeah.
Exactly. And this is so nice. But we need to get there. And on the other hand, yes, we need the life experiences, as Andrea was saying. We cannot just be, there is the other extreme. There is the talented people that are lazy because they think, oh, I'm so talented, I don't need to work, which is not the beginning of the end, it's already the end when you think like this. But then you have the other extreme, people that practice in a chamber for 17 hours and sleep for 7 hours every day. And so they practice more than anybody. But then they are missing the life. Mm. And without the life experience, you cannot tell a story. You cannot tell the story in a Beethoven sonata. If you have not lived, if you don't know what joy is, if you don't know what it is to be drunk or to be sad or to be happy or to, you know, to celebrate or to suffer or whatever it is. But you cannot just lock yourself in a room and practice the whole time.
And I think this is a complicated balance that we all navigate through our careers. And at times we're more on one side and others we're more, you know, we go through these waves. And I think this is part of growing up as a musician and coming into your own. It's learning how, and to also accept it. Sometimes you need to practice more. Other times, maybe you need to let go a bit and to trust yourself.
True.
Chrysler, for example, I was just reading, he was totally against practice. Okay, but it's Fritz Chrysler. Like, how many Chryslers are there in music history? One. He's saying that, you know, it all happens in the head. I tried this, it didn't work for me.
For me neither.
I sound like shit, excuse my French, when I don't practice. But for Chrysler it worked and he sounded like a god. He played a little bit out of tune, as we all do at times. But we all have to find our own, as Sarah is saying. We need to understand the dynamic. Everyone needs whatever we need. Somebody needs 1 hour a day, somebody needs 10 hours a day, somebody, you know. It's really personal. And also
not to feel bad. I mean, if you're somebody, maybe you're a really fast learner and maybe you're a really slow learner. That's fantastic. You'll both end up on stage doing the same thing. And how each one of us gets there, that's our own journey. And we should never feel shame about that.
You know? Sure, yeah. We were talking also about identity, artistic identity. Of course, each and every one of you has his own identity. But you also, besides being players, you are also a conductor. You have been working for many, many years in a string quartet. You are a concertmaster at the Santa Cecilia Orchestra. So you do experience also what means to be a leader. Andrea, what means to be 27 years old, the leader, concertmaster of one of the most important orchestra that we have in Europe? How do you deal with your identity of a leader?
Yeah, it takes a big personal work and continuous research because you are the bridge. And that's what maybe leaders feel like, that you are somehow, you connect and you are transmitting and you try to look for these transitions. And that's where I love my passion, because it makes me also think, even though I'm leading, that I have to connect to other points. And in chamber music it happens, and in solo playing, think about it, right, Julian, like when you're conducting or you're playing, or both, and then you see that others are not playing back, and so that there is, you know, and this factor of making art and or playing together, this is one important factor of this. And characters, personalities. Where should I put my personality? Where should I take, go away? And then maybe, or when I should maybe make peace, or maybe get these energies maybe a little bit away from each other, maybe they would stand better in this, and maybe they would find this balance. Or maybe, you know, there are so many options, and I'm learning this because I am, you know, like, as it's so rare, and it needs to happen now, and this is the transition that we're going to have. We're going to have leaders that are younger. You really, to keep the ears open full time. Also, and this, I think one thing that helped me, and I really went straight on the wall to learn this, because my Sicilian guts sometimes got in the way, and maybe sometimes personally get in the way. I feel that really try to think and do, maybe not do, but think mostly. What would happen if I was the opposite? This factor, like, why does it sound like such an alien, this conductor, to me? And it happens, I mean. And it will happen to soloists that have to play Brahms Concerto or second movement of Sibelius, and oh, this is not the right pulse, and then you need to anyway make the concert, and you need to work with what you get. And then you will complain about it, maybe, or also you will see, oh, I learned something tonight. At the same time, because if not, we get depressed, or if not, we get too much pumped up, and we stop some circulation of energy. I see that, yeah, and yeah, I think this is.
Julian, you're conducting more and more. Being a conductor helped you to expand your artistic personality. I mean, you are kind of different artist while you are conducting.
Yeah, it made me realize that all these violin concertos, how unimportant the soloist is. I love that. I get to experience all these concertos and realize the, you know, that the second bassoon and sometimes the trombone and, you know, even the tuba. All these things. You start to listen and take yourself a little bit less serious. You know? And of course, it's a completely different profession. You know, to play as a soloist, which I'm doing now for 34 years, I think. But that does not qualify you to step in front of an orchestra as a conductor. You think that it does because you have played with most of the wonderful orchestras and conductors and you have seen it all. And then you come in front of an orchestra and you are helpless and the musicians are going to eat you alive. And you have exactly 30 seconds maximum, correct me if
yes,
I'm wrong, Andrea, in the first rehearsal, not in the first concert. And, you know, anyways, they're asking themselves in the beginning when an orchestra doesn't know you as a conductor, what is the violinist doing here teaching us how to play a Beethoven symphony? It's ridiculous. So you start kind of with this attitude. And, so I studied conducting for 15 years very, very seriously. So what I'm trying to say is everything what we are doing here is very important, but we should not forget that it takes time. You know, if you really take classical music seriously, no matter teaching or playing in a string quartet, in a trio, in a quintet, sextet, septet, octet, nonet, whatever it is, chamber orchestra, leading, sitting last desk violas, last desk cellos, like my father did all his life. He played in the, let's say, fourth orchestra in Vienna, last stand cello all his life, and he's a wonderful musician, and he taught me a lot about respecting as a leader, to have respect to every single musician in the orchestra. This was so important, and it helps me a lot when I stand in front of an orchestra. And it's a very psychological also work, because you're exposed to, let's say, between 50 and 100 people, And if something doesn't work, or if somebody says something provokingly, you are exposed because you are alone as the conductor.
I would be your friend anyway.
Oh, yes. You don't know me yet.
Yeah, but anyway.
No, but it's a very interesting work because what is the role of a conductor? The conductor has the role to inspire the orchestra and to somehow hope that the orchestra will be ready for her or his journey, for the concept of a conductor, because yes, the conductor, this is how it is structured, is leading the rehearsals, so is leading the interpretation of the symphonic piece or of the piece that is being performed. And if you have the right elements, if you have the technique, if you have the right way of communicating, of respecting the musicians, but at the same time to be a strong leader and to be a truthful musician. And if you manage to convey and to convince the whole orchestra, then something interesting might happen.
Sara, you have been a founding member of Linden String Quartet. So what means to create a music project along with other three artists?
Yeah, I mean, the idea of being a leader is a bit of a complicated topic in a string quartet, especially as first violinist, because at least in our quartet, you don't really have leaders and followers. I mean, I think in any musical situation, we shouldn't have leaders. We should all be leading together. But I think this was a huge lesson for me, getting to play this repertoire and really starting to understand what it is to share leadership. And it had a really big effect on me. I think I will always be a collaborator. I'm not, I think we're all more powerful when we learn how to work with our colleagues. It sounds very corny, but we're stronger together. I mean, I look at Stauffer, for example. We need each other. We need to support each other. We need to find ways to reach across the table. We spoke about this a little the other night. Having studied in the US and then now living in Europe, I feel, at least in my world, there's a huge disconnect. I mean, you also studied in the US. I knew nothing about Europe when I was in the States, and I think a lot of Europeans, and I think it's such a small music world, and we have to find ways for organizations and also as artists to be leaders together and to find the places where we can collaborate, where we can grow our audiences together, where we can share ideas. So leadership for me, coming from the quartet, I think, yeah, it needs to be a group.
I agree with that, absolutely. So before opening for a Q&A and get some questions from our students, one other question from my side. You have been, you know, bringing back to Cremona three incredible instruments. You're all playing on Cremonese instruments, on Del Gesù, on a Storione, on a Stradivari. So what means for you to be now the player of an instrument that has 300 years old, 350, no? And this legacy that now is in your hands. And we were talking with Antoine Tamesti, who brought his viola back here in Cremona, and he was crying when he saw the sign just off the home of Stradivari saying, here Stradivari made the viola that now Antoine is playing. So I was saying, wow, 400 years ago, here Stradivari made the viola that now I'm playing. Wow. What is this feeling that now you're keeping music alive on an historical instrument?
It was new completely until 6.5 years ago for me. I have never tried an old instrument before that because it's so hard to have. And also sometimes it's just a question of luck. Yeah. In my case, it was great luck. And definitely we have to talk about how to get this transition a little smoother, because there is so much talent. There are so many instruments not being played, and it's really so frustrating. From Sicily, you know, if you think about it, there were so many instruments in the conservatory just back in the, I said, like, what is going on? And it's so sad. And these instruments, they lose their lives if they don't, if they are not vibrating. And I'm not saying that in museums there should not be violins or cellos or fortepianos. I'm just saying, let's choose them, let's see, and maybe make them temporary or something. I don't know. Let's look for this
more
transition.
Available.
Yes, more available. Mm. Definitely. Or more presenters in the museums that play all every day. I don't know. And especially here in Cremona, it's already being done, and right. I see artists coming and performing on the instruments in the museum, but not all over the world. Definitely what it is for me, fortune, and it's, first of all, we treat our instruments, maybe I can speak for everybody, and what doesn't matter if it is a Cremonese instrument, it's a French instrument, if it's a Finnish or Norwegian, but definitely as a part of our own body, and it teaches us also, if we respect our instrument, it means it will vibrate better, and it will transmit our voice better. It means also we will start to take care of ourselves a little bit more. And also this is what is the magic of these instruments of 300 years ago. Thinking about the climate in those times, in those years, and then you see your instrument and you see the black lines and you see, wow, look at those winter seasons. It's amazing. And now you find that they are protected, this, because there was a fire some years ago, and they're finally getting new seeds and grow new trees. But that climate and meeting with Stradivari, such a great masters of Guarneri, Storioni, Bergonzi, we can keep going. I don't know. It's to be also, you know, to come back here and think about like Stamesti, you know, like in front of the shop. It is. It makes you feel, wow, I have a big responsibility. Mm. And for me, I'm Italian. I feel it. It doesn't change anything. But maybe I feel that, wow, this was made in my country, and I after studying abroad and everything, I wanted to come back and play also, and maybe play in Italy, these instruments that were made in Italy.
Sara, Julian?
I completely agree. This connection to the past that we feel when we hold these instruments, when we get to know these instruments. Getting the huge honor to play the viola Storioni. Every day, learned so much from this instrument. I think this will be forever my teacher. But I also agree that it's highly unfair who gets... these instruments are so out of all of our reach, and it's really luck. And of course, hard work, but a lot of hardworking musicians never get to touch these instruments. I think it's also important to also not ignore the living makers right now, because I think there are some really phenomenal makers who are doing great work, making beautiful, beautiful instruments. Of course, Cremona still has, forever, the tradition. This is the place that everyone comes to. And yeah, also to keep supporting this so that everyone can play on a wonderful instrument. Of course, we don't have 2 million strads, but absolutely to have the experience to play on one of these instruments is a great, great honor.
Right. Julian?
I think the people that have the power, we have to make sure to minimize the luck factor.
Yes.
So, and I strongly believe that if somebody has a really, really extraordinary talent, that there should be absolutely no luck factor. This should be wiped out. But there you need people who have access maybe to other people and to other people and then to get to the top, to the people who decide and who can, you know, buy or distribute or loan, you know, an instrument to a talent.
So the problem is they often don't have the knowledge, right, of what it is. So yeah, finding those people to educate.
But then it is also our obligation to convince, because we have access to people that know people that know people. So yeah, it's a joint effort, and it should really not happen that somebody absolutely of extraordinary talent is left for years with a horrible or terrible instrument. Yeah. This should not happen.
And at the same time, I was thinking about that, if I can say one more, that maybe also this luck factor it could be minimized if the violin making now would be supported more. Because I find that also there is lack of knowledge in the masters of nowadays. It's hard to find somebody, you know, that, I mean, now it's somehow starting to grow, but I find it is, already it's incomparable.
Of course.
Yeah, right? Because of the wood, the first material and everything. So, already. But also to create some sort of middle ground, and also to give the opportunity for real to give support to the new violin makers. It will make also younger generations to find a first violin, a second violin, a third violin, and I don't know.
Absolutely. Yes. You've had Peter Greiner was here, one of the greatest living violin makers. I love his instruments. We know, all of us, we know fantastic violin makers, and really, with all due respect, but there is not only the great old Italian instruments that we are so crazy about, and of course they are the religion, so to say, but let's not stop being very active and talking to the living makers. Absolutely. Talking, discussing, it's like composers who find their favorite musicians to play their music and to create a composition, right? It was always historically composers. We say for us the composers are our gods and we are the sort of the servants, but the composers say without us their music is just on nothing. It's it's strange things on a piece of paper.
Of course. Well, I'm proud to say that, you know, here in Cremona we have a community of 120 violin makers. We have a museum with, you know, an incredible collection of instruments. Our foundation, we do own a very special historical instruments collection, and every week we give access to young players to this collection. They are able to play on these instruments, but I totally agree with you. We need more commitment from other foundations and organizations to make accessible this heritage to the future generation of musicians, and here we are. So it's time for questions from our students. Please, any question from your side, guys, to our artists, please.
I have one question. So what about the new generation of listeners? As if you said that in this room are sitting talented musicians of the new generation, who is going to listen to them in the future?
Who is going to?
Who is going to listen to them, say, in 10 or 50 years?
So what about the audience of tomorrow? Basically. Okay. Another question. We collect maybe a couple of questions. Please.
I'm wondering, because I'm on a time of my life that I'm almost finishing my study, and I'm kind of like in this position that I'm a bit confused how can I teach myself further? And I noticed that sometimes, even when we are presented to the same piece, we see very, very different things. Some people might see just the notes, and some people see the music figures, the phrasing, rhetorics, and even like psychological analysis. And some people get a glimpse of humanity behind. And I wonder, like, how can I see the things that I don't see, and what advice or what kind of experience do you have in your music journey to every day discover a little bit new things from the same piece or from a piece that you have been played for, I don't know, 20, 30 years? How do you keep it fresh and to have a bigger, always bigger and bigger vision out of it?
Okay, well, very interesting questions. I will have to ask you to make short questions because we are running off time.
I just didn't ask, I didn't understand how do we
grow the audience?
Grow the audience, grow. Or listen to some. Did you also say listen to?
The new generation of listeners, the audience.
Okay, yes. So how do we grow the audience? Mm.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I think it's everyone sitting in this room is our responsibility. I think we live in an age now of communication, and I know different parts of the world have different feelings on this, but for me, I do believe as much as we can communicate to our audiences why we love what we do, why we're playing what we're playing. I had experiences where, yeah, I'm trying to play a Berg Opus 3 quartet for audience in Idaho. I mean, this is like, there's absolutely no connection. But if you stand in front of them and you explain to them what was happening in Vienna at the time, and it was the end of the world and everything, not just the world was falling, but also tonality. And then all of a sudden they're like, oh, wow. And they kind of get on board with you. And I feel, okay, this is one small example, but maybe these are the small building blocks where we can start piquing people's interests. Mm.
Julian, would you like to answer to the other question?
Absolutely. Play chamber music. Find people that you love. That, go everywhere where you can to like places like this. Ask questions. What do you think about this? It's like I go to every single conductor, I ask him about Beethoven 5 or whatever, symphony. It doesn't mean that I'm going to do anything what they tell me, but it's important to get into communication. And communication, how is the easiest form of communication and the most intimate form of musical communication is chamber music. No matter what you will end up doing, but I think talking, exchanging information with words, but then with music is the best way to learn.
And your colleagues could be your teachers.
You have so many teachers here, look. Yeah. Talk to all of us. And then you make your own ideas from that. And this is a never-ending process until we fall dead.
Are there two final questions? One.
In your opinion, what are the most
okay. Mm-hmm. Last one.
Is it this specific? I would like to ask Mr. Rachlin, what was your perspective on Mr. Pushkin's teaching? When you
I don't think.
What was your perspective on Mr. Pushkin's teaching when you were young, and how did you evolve from it?
My first?
Your perspective.
My perspective. I was his first student, so he had no idea that he was a teacher. I had no idea that I could play violin. So it was very interesting situation. So he started teaching and I started listening to what he was saying, and we did it for 15 years. I had four lessons. At least four lessons a week. Every lesson was between 3 and 5 hours. And so I was extremely lucky. And then at a certain point I realized that I need to have other influences, which he supported always. He never was pressing. He always was teaching only until a certain point. And always about a week before the concert he said, please forget everything that I told you. From now until the concert, you need to forget everything what I told you. But of course it was inside of me. And like this, he did not kill sort of whatever there was, what you call talent. And this is a very important obligation also for a teacher, also for a teacher with strong opinions, never to kill the student. And of course also to recognize when the student needs other inspirations. So Abnabelung, yeah, so to cut the cord. And we cut the cords after 15 years, but we are closest friends, and I will be forever grateful to my dear Boris for being my unbelievable tutor and friend, and yeah. And maybe you can answer, or Andrea.
Yeah, Sarah, Andrea, please. The most important human qualities.
This is very, very deep. I think for each person, it's personal. For me, to be a great musician is to be a great, a kind, empathetic person. I tend to find my favorite musicians tend to be people I do really like, although there are a few exceptions. But yeah, I think that this whole career and competition, this all, one has to be focused on their work, on their friends, on their colleagues, supporting their colleagues.
Generosity, I think like if you meet somebody, yeah, that knows that his limits or her limits, and but anyway is willing to share, and this is I think it's the first thing we do, right? When we play, we give. So that's
also people like to collaborate with people they like. That's one thing I noticed. Great artists like to play with artists they like. It's not always the best artist, the fastest player. It's the people they respect and like.
In fact, it works like that also as with concertmasters. Usually, you know, so you can have a very virtuosic concertmaster as well. If you're playing an Heldenleben, nowadays there is no anymore those concertmasters that can only them play those. Now their level is getting higher. So it's most likely to be a musician that could work with everybody, that could include also those that are not perfect or something. They think also that include the opposite, something also. The friendship is, it happens to us that, right, as you said, there are a few exceptions, right? Because we are, life brings us also at the beginning to have a face it in front of you and you say, oh, maybe I don't want to be this kind of musician, but I would like to be this kind of human being, or the opposite. Or, you know, I would like to, wow, what a musician, but what a human being. Yes.
And I think it's also very important not to have the goal to have a great career. Mm. This is the worst thing that you can have. Yeah. To have said, but I want to be very famous, or I want to have a big career. This is the beginning of the end. You cannot do this mistake to be verkrampft, we say. Mm. You know what is verkrampft? To be very uptight. And that I need to become very successful.
Because
you will not become successful with this attitude.
Yeah.
You just need to focus slowly on the music. Right. Slowly. And it will take many, many, many years. Yeah. And the rest will happen without you noticing.
Yeah. So it's about being authentic, it's about being kind, it's about being generous, like you have been tonight with us. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really, thank you, Julian, Sarah, Andrea, for being here with us. To our students, and of course to the people that have been watching us on streaming, this is the aim of this conversation, to reach from Cremona, hopefully, the entire music community out there with the ideas and vision from great artists and young musicians from the next generations. So thank you very much for following us, and I would like again to thank you, all of you, for being here with us in Cremona at the Stauffer Academy. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.